to have an immediate impression that is indeed Russian music. You don't know it's an opera because there's no singing there, but it is from Russian opera. And it was brought to the Metropolitan Opera 2 or 3 years ago. And I went to hear this opera because the only thing I'd ever heard in my life was the overture. I couldn't imagine what the rest of it sounded like. I'd heard another opera by this man, which sounded much of the time like an Italian opera sung in Russian. But this opera staggered me because it was as Russian and vivid and brilliant as music that is quite familiar often in the concert hall, such as the Polovtsian Dances from Prince Igor of Borodin. This was written almost 50 years before that. This is Glinka. It is the opera Ruslan and Rudmila. It's a lezginka. It's an Asian dance that comes as a sort of little episode linked to the opera. And almost immediately, we have a vivid example of something happening in music that is really quite astonishing. And that is the springing to life of Russian music as well as Russian opera. I always have to think of things that I ought to say and cover myself before we start. I am not a Russian speaker, although I spent a month there and I learned the alphabet. I can sound words out and I can even understand some words when I hear them in recordings. But if you're any of you are Russian speakers and you hear me mispronounce anything, be prepared for that. I wanted very much to have a discussion about opera in Eastern Europe, which would be, title-wise, Russia and Czech opera. The more I looked into this, the more I felt that the real emphasis need to be on Russian opera, because it is such an extraordinary, rich tradition that spills right over into the 20th century. I'll make some comments as we go along about Czech opera, but interestingly enough, that will, in a funny way, be better addressed in about 2 or 3 weeks when the first of May is a Tuesday. On that date, I'll be talking about Janáček, a composer who wrote operas in Czech, and that links back with what I will be talking about today. So I believe it's probably a better focus to give the attention to Russian music. There was no Russian music before Glinka. You can find obscure names, that's about as well as you're going to find. Russian music literally sprang to life in one single hop. It's astonishing that it did, and it still is one of the most amazing periods in the history of music. Russia, remember, had no Renaissance. It was bypassed completely by the Renaissance. And the Russia of the 18th, well into the 19th century, was a society with a remarkably small population of very well-to-do people, mostly aristocrats, who preferred to speak French among themselves, spoke Russian to the servants, and on the whole regarded the unique expression of Russian culture as something second rate and not worthy of real attention. And this situation carried on well into the 19th century. For example, Italian opera became very, very fashionable in St. Petersburg right after the Napoleonic Wars with the connivance of Tsar Nicholas I, who did everything he could to stand in the way of Russian work, of Russian composers. He discouraged it, and almost nothing was done to encourage the expression of Russian nationhood in music, particularly in opera. Indeed, Italian opera was so popular that there was a period right around up to about 1860, when St. Petersburg was the equal of Vienna, London, and Paris in the opera world, which is a little hard to believe and very little known. La Forza del Destino of Verdi had its world premiere in St. Petersburg. That is no accident. And for about 20 years, there was almost no activity whatever in the Russian language. Russian language was actively discouraged when it came to opera. The attitude was, why would we need that? We have these wonderful riches coming out of Italy. Now, this was, of course, a period all over Europe, even in countries that did not have quite the same political problems to deal with. That we speak of, and it has a lot to do, of course, with the period of Romanticism and even the aftershocks of the 1848 revolutions all over Europe, which all were failures, which is nationalism became a very powerful force in music in almost all countries, even in Germany, but it certainly was true in Eastern Europe. Now, in some cases, such as Czechoslovakia, kind of using the modern names of that country, you had a province of the Austrian Empire where everything was to be done in German. One will read that the composer Smetana learned Czech in his 30s. He didn't know how to read and write the language. And he wrote two or three operas before he even got it right. He was very dedicated to the notion of the culture of his own country, and especially to get away from the oppression of Austrian dominance. But ironically, he came from a German-speaking family, and that was the language he knew best, and he had to learn the language. And there was a period in the case of the Czechs where a very small percentage of the educated population even spoke Czech. This was turned around by the desire for national expression and also to be free of the oppression that came out of Vienna. Now, in the case of Russia, Russia wasn't oppressed by anybody else, but there was, in a sense, a kind of cultural oppression that they welcomed in their own right. They had, for an entire century, opened their doors to French culture in particular. And they also opened their doors to Italian opera, and some of the most important opera productions in Italian in the 18th century took place in St. Petersburg, and a whole who's who of important composers came there and had their works performed. And the Russians were delighted to have it just that way. It took a change that came about in the generation after the Napoleonic Wars that began to make a very big difference. And the idea of having opera is a very interesting thing because, of course, opera is, in a sense, the most public of all of the musical forms. It has an audience, it has stories, it has the kind of thing that can attract attention, and particularly in the political sense. And of course, the famous example is Verdi, whose operas for a whole generation were, in a sense, metaphors for the idea of Italian independence from the Austrians and for Italian unity. We forget that today. Even the Italians had a problem with this idea of cultural identification. But opera seemed to be an ideal form for people to seek to express their identity. And also has a lot to do with language. We should remember, for example, that when opera spread to France, it was an Italian that made it possible, Jean-Baptiste Lully. He went to his friend Molière to have lessons in the inflection of the language because he knew if you write opera in French, you've got to get the language absolutely right or it's false, it doesn't work. And he succeeded brilliantly. And when opera spread to other countries, language was always a supremely important matter. That was true in the Czech opera. It was true in the 20th century in Hungarian opera. And it was also very true in the 19th century in Russia, because after all, they wanted to have Russian used as the vehicle in these stage works. This was a very, very important thing that began to take place at that time. And there was a very, very powerful impetus in all of the arts at that time to break away from the subservience to Western European models. And ironically, they're often in the hands of people who are very, very imbued with the Western European culture, above all Alexander Pushkin. The more one looks at Russian opera, the more it's essential to talk about Pushkin almost as much as you talk about Mussorgsky or Tchaikovsky. Here was a man born in 1799 who spoke French most of the time. And he was very good at language. He also knew English. He read Byron in English. He read Voltaire. He read the writers and the poets and the philosophers of Western Europe. And they are, in fact, referred to in his writings. You read Pushkin, he's constantly making references to the great classics and the writers and the philosophers of Western Europe. But it was he that, especially in his works, drew upon the folklore and the traditions of Russia and the music of the language itself. And the other thing about Pushkin is, although he only lived to be 38 and he was killed in a stupid duel, it's exactly as stupid as the duel in his most famous work, Evgeny Onegin, the opera. You may know it's Eugene Onegin, I'm going to try to pronounce it correctly, where there is an idiotic duel at the heart of the opera. Exactly what happened to poor Pushkin. Pushkin, in those 38 years, wrote an avalanche of poems, short stories, novels, plays, essays, criticism. It's hard to believe that one man could cram so much into such a short life. He wrote the original draft of Evgeny Onegin when he was in his early 20s. He was an astonishing character, and really, it's amazing how little we really know about him in the West. The Russians, of course, know better. He is their Shakespeare, and rightly so. Now, the things that began to change opera in Russia was the coming to the fore of a very talented generation of composers. Almost all of the composers after Glinka were born within about 5 years of each other. They're all born 1839, Mussorgsky, 1840, 1840, Tchaikovsky, Rimsky-Korsakov, 1844. I forget where Bordin comes in, roughly the same time. They're all about the same generation. They all knew each other. They didn't always agree about everything, but this was a tremendous ferment of activity and great, great skills that came to the fore at that time. And the work that really began to make its way in the Russian world in the opera house came in the 1870s and 80s. It also had to do with the change in the attitudes under Tsar Alexander II, and especially Alexander III. Those two czars gave great encouragement, unlike Nicholas I. And indeed, when the big opera house in St. Petersburg, which was a smelly old place, when it burned down in 1860, they built a new theater called the Mariinsky Theater. That's the opera house today. That's where the Kirov Opera performs. And why they use that name, I don't know, because Kirov was a bloody henchman of Stalin, although he was murdered by Stalin. I mean, I think they would get rid of the name. I'd be called the Tchaikovsky Opera Company. At any rate, I myself spent a month in the Soviet Union in 1962. And I must say, it transformed my view of Russian music radically. And I must say, a single opera performance was a really great occasion in my case. I, of course, hoped to see Boris Godunov, an opera I knew from about the age of 12. It wasn't on at the Bolshoi. They were doing instead War and Peace of Prokofiev. I went and sat in an audience which had a lot of people in military uniform and factory workers. This was one case where their socialist goals were being lived up to. And I realized this was a big national epic for them. This was a powerful, powerful expression of their nationhood here in the 20th century, even though, of course, here was a story set in the period of 1812, written during the next big invasion of Russia, which was the Nazi invasion in the early 1940s. This was a very powerful identifying work of art that grew that audience in a way that is really remarkable. That opera is being performed at the Metropolitan this next year, and I urge you all to go and see it. It's a very great and remarkable work. But we have this great outpouring that began in the 1860s. And of those people, Mussorgsky is the one that in many respects we think of first. Yet he was a very, in a way, a flawed composer. He was so disorganized in his life, hardly anything he wrote was ever really finished. Even Boris Godunov has two competing versions. You can buy a CD which has both of them. You can choose which way you want to hear it. But in that generation of Mussorgsky, we have something that goes far beyond what Glinka did. There is this powerful identification with the language, with the sounds and the rhythms of speech of peasants and folk people, of music of the church, and an awareness of their history. And a particular focus was that of Pushkin. And I think here we should go directly in and have a look at what I'm talking about with Boris Godunov. Pushkin's in a funny place, here we go. Boris Godunov was described by Mussorgsky as a national patriot, national historical opera. And of course, as with so many of these, it is an elaboration of a play by Pushkin, based on history of this very, very tragic figure, Boris Godunov, one of the last czars before the Romanov dynasty came in the early 1600s. A czar that became czar through the death of a small child who was one of the last sons of Ivan the Terrible, and it's never quite clear if he was murdered by orders of Boris, but the implication is that he was, and he certainly is haunted by the fact that that young man died. And we have a story in which the famous scene of the coronation scene, which I will not play you, but with other things which really show remarkable ideas that he expressed in a new way of writing opera altogether. And in this, by the way, the pages I've given you, I should explain, the first page of text, and I've given you these in case you'd rather follow it rather than try to see it on the screen. The first is actually labeled first excerpt. The other page has a photograph of Tsar Boris on one side. That's the second excerpt. And the other, the back side of that, is the third excerpt. This, by the way, is a very interesting staging. It was done by the great film director who died, sadly, very shortly after the breakup of the Soviet Union, Andrei Tarkovsky. Tarkovsky was a very great filmmaker and a very interesting production this is indeed. The scene I want to play you first is one in which we have music that reflects Mussorgsky's fascination with folk music, with the rhythms and the natural flow of the language, and even the music of children and games and the kinds of things that come out of the soil of Russia. And it's a scene in the opera where the Tsarevich, the crown prince, hears sung by a woman, which is the 19th century pattern. They would have a woman sing a boy rather than have some squeaky young fellow with his voice changing in the middle of the opera. Fyodor is with the nurse and with his sister Xenia, and they're singing songs and playing and having games. Into this comes the Tsar himself. He's at home, he's in private with them. And we see this other side of this man who previously we've seen as a great authoritarian figure. Here he comes in and he is a father. He's a loving father, and the tenderness of the music that he sings is really quite memorable. And it's very interesting because if you hear some of the songs of Mussorgsky, they have this offer this very rough, repetitive, rhythmic quality that seems to be very, very much coming out of the peasant intonations of Russian. You might wonder, can this man write a real tune? Can he write an aria? You discover that indeed he can. This one shows it quite nicely. This is Fyodor. His daughter. monologue. We move directly on into this very tender music with the family and thinking about his daughter and this little boy, him being an utterly human character. This, of course, also has a lot to do with Pushkin, because Pushkin has this Shakespearean ability to see all sides of all kinds of characters and to bring them to life in this really vibrant way that invites music. Small wonder when his works began to be digested by Russian-speaking intellectuals who are a little tired of doing things in French. They were so drawn to his work. By the way, I'll forget this if I don't mention it now. It has nothing to do with what I've just said, but I'll just mention the spread of the work of Pushkin. He's absolutely incredible. The page that I've given you, which lists all these composers who wrote Russian operas, on the back of it, there's an article about Pushkin from the Grove Dictionary of Music. And if you look carefully, there's an opera in 1912 written by Leon Cavallo, the man that wrote Pagliacci, wrote a Pushkin opera called Zingari, Gypsies. I mean, ye gods is all I can say. Well, I want to take us forward now to the... Now, you have that other page that has a photograph on it. This is the remarkable scene in which we have the Tsar tortured by the thought of the murder of this boy. And he is also being toyed with by his sort of his prime minister, Shuisky, a prince, who is a slippery character. If you'll forgive me putting it this way, I always think he's kind of Boris's Henry Kissinger. And if you remember the book where Kissinger and Nixon knelt and prayed together, it's amazing. It's practically this very scene, as a matter of fact. If you're devotees of the Dear Doctor, please forgive me. Joke. Shuisky is a real operator, a clever, as I say, tricky guy. And he asks him, what about this child's death? What was it? What can you tell me? Russian culture, particularly opera, has always depended upon people who bring it out of Russia and bring it to us. The first performance in the West of Boris Godunov was 1908 in Paris. It was Sergei Diaghilev who took the company over, and it stunned the Paris audience. Of course, immediately after that, they were even more stunned when they saw Nijinsky and the Russian ballet. The ballet transferred much better to Paris than Russian opera did, and Russian opera didn't really enter repertoire in quite the way that one might have expected. Indeed, that's part of the problem. Why is Russian opera so, on the whole, rather little known? Part of it probably is simply the language, although increasingly people are learning to sing it. I'm going to show you part of Yevgeny Onegin, and Tatiana is sung by Mirella Franny, an excellent Russian, and she's Italian. The fact that she could do it is a sign of some interesting changes. But the language is part of it. The isolation of Russia way over there in the old days, and still way over there behind the Iron Curtain. So we had double isolation right until 10 years ago. Of course, in some ways that's been good. It's helped to preserve a style of performance and acting, and even a sound of the voices with this communist quarantine. That's the good part of the story. Now that the quarantine is lifted, now they're flooding over here. We're beginning to hear them, and there's some fear that distinct Russianness of the Russian performers is going to be diluted into the kind of international style that we have everywhere else. Because it's true, you go from New York to Paris to London to Vienna, performances more or less sound exactly the same. There's no longer a very distinct sound to Paris or to Vienna or to New York. Although Russia still has that sound, and I hope they can preserve it. And Gergiev is doing now what Diaghilev did 9 years ago. What I want to do now is to show you a remarkable scene that comes toward the end of the opera. There's an enormous problem with Boris Godunov. There are two different versions. There are versions that are conflations of the two versions, in which you move a scene from one version to a different place in the other version. I will not even attempt to tell you about them, except to say there's enormous confusion about what version you want to have. And then, for the better part of 80 years or so, it was never heard in the version the composer wrote anyway, regardless of which one you're talking about, because shortly after the death of Mussorgsky, he had a helping hand from Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov, who these days gets kicked a lot for this. I think he deserves a lot of praise, actually. He felt that Mussorgsky's music was too rough-hewn. It needed some smoothing out of the orchestration, even some of the harmonies, in order, frankly, to sell it. And until very recently, the version he always heard was Boris, the Boris of Rimsky-Korsakov, which was a very glamorous version. When we began to hear Mussorgsky's version, or more or less Mussorgsky's version, because Shostakovich did a version which is pretty close to the original of Mussorgsky. It has that roughness, it has that darkness. It doesn't have quite the sheen that you have. If you want sheen, go and listen to the Rimsky recording. But if you want what the man really wrote, the version that I'm showing you now comes pretty close to it. There is a scene which, depending on which version you're talking about, either comes at the very end of the opera or not long before the death of Boris. See, one version ends with Boris dying, curtain falls, we're in tears, the hero is dead. And of course, that's a version that makes Boris the center of the opera. The other version, Boris dies, and then there is further action, including scenes of crowds of people and the invading army of this false Dmitri that comes in and actually claimed the throne of Russia, and actually had an opera written about him by Antonin Dvorak called Dmitri. There is a sequel to Boris Godunov, and it's written by Dvorak, which is rather incredible to think about. But it doesn't matter which end of the opera you're talking about to simply have you hear this scene. I prefer the version that ends with the crowds, because I personally believe, as a lot of people do increasingly, that the real focus of the opera is Russia. It's the people. It's the great mass of Russia. It's not really an opera so much about one man as what he represents with this country. And he constantly talks about it in those terms. And of course, at the end, we see various ways the embodiment of the Russian people in various ways. It's a very powerful choral opera, like a lot of Russian opera. Russian opera is a very important element of the chorus, and often representing the great mass of the people. Here there is a scene with a simpleton, a simple-minded guy. In Russian folklore, such a character was often referred to as Eurodivy. Eurodivy is a little bit like the fool in King Lear. That is to say, a kind of slightly retarded character who has the privilege to go right up to the king or monarch or czar and tell him the truth, whether he wants to hear it or not, and not be mistreated. It's called a holy fool, is another translation of Eurodivy. And this fellow is the Eurodivy, he's a simpleton. He's had a penny stolen from him, and he confronts Tsar Boris. It's an amazing scene. First we see him with a crowd of children teasing him, mercilessly.
Oh!
words are on the back of the page. You just go through it. anything remotely like this in its power, originality, and shared poignancy. But it reminds me of the end of a very different piece of music, and that's the opera Quetzecca, which means you're just kind of stunned, something that strips away all of the outer veneer of human tradition and exposes it as it really is. There is another opera of Mussorgsky. I gave you a complete list that most of his operas either are sort of early stages of finding his footing, or they're unfinished, or they're very sketchy form in many cases. The greatest and most frustrating one is the opera he wrote after this, Kovacchina, which he spent the better part of 10 years writing. And it takes enormous skill to just piece together what you're going to hear any performance of this opera, because there are parts that literally were not even set to music. It's set at the time of enormous upheaval in Russian life between the forces of modernism represented by Peter the Great, building St. Petersburg and westernizing Russia, dragging them into the Western world, whether they liked it or not, and religious opposition to this, particularly a group of very fanatical traditionalists in the Russian church who are called the Old Believers, who at the end of the opera, in despair and frustration, immolate themselves. They go into a large wooden building and they set it on fire and they sing as they die. It's an absolutely horrifying, powerful ending, needless to say. And I don't have a video of it, but you have the words. I just want you to hear this, because here again is this ability to express things using the chorus in a very, very powerful way. And of course, without going into any technicalities, this is music that even now still has a very, very almost strange individuality and a quality that struck people as very radical, very modern, and indeed even sort of the product of someone who didn't really know what he was doing. That's what some people thought. Of course, he thought about Beethoven, too, at the end of his life, that he was deaf, didn't know what he was doing, so that's why the music sounded strange, and the music of Mussorgsky sounded strange to some people, and poor old Rimsky-Korsakov gets the kick in the slack for that one, because he attempted to ameliorate these things and smooth it out. He, in fact, helped rescue this, and what I want you to do is to hear this very final bit. It's 4 minutes of amazing music.
Thank you.
Laurence about whether I should play a mere 4 minutes from this work in isolation or not. I thought I would, because there's a sheer concentration of power that comes through in that concluding section that is a clue to a very powerful, extraordinarily dark and gripping opera. It's a dumb thing to say, but if Boris is his Hamlet, this is his King Lear. It's a very difficult opera. It's made difficult, but the stage is left in. But it's well worth the effort when you have a really fine performance, which does come along every now and then. When bell freezes over, Mr. Gergiev is usually the one who makes it possible. This is an example of a type of opera that is very popular at this time. In fact, there are a number of very basic styles of opera that Russians began to figure in. The folkloric type of opera, a famous example is the Prince Igor of Borodin, the Polovtian dances, give you a clue to that. There are the operas that are folk or fantastic, fairy tale kinds of operas. They're often comedies. A lot of them are written by Rimsky-Korsakov. There are realistic or naturalistic operas. A lot of those are the finest operas of Tchaikovsky. The historical ones are these, and there is even a rather supernatural, or sometimes called a surreal opera, and that's the Queen of Spades of Tchaikovsky, which I want to say a word about in a few minutes. I want to give you a little taste of an opera that I saw on that same amazing visit when the Kirov Opera came to New York, and the operas that no one ever heard before. Not only did you Rustler of Ludmilla of Glinka, which was just a name to most of us. They did an opera I don't think I ever knew existed. An opera based on a Pushkin play or story, not sure which, called Mazeppa. It was better known as a piece of music for orchestra written by Franz Liszt of that title. And I went to see this opera expecting it to be a blustering, kind of roaring lot of blood and thunder. And well, it could roar. Here is probably briefly what it's about. It's about enormous troubles going on between Tsar Peter the Great and Mazeppa, who has been in and out of being a favorite of the Tsar and in rebellion against the Tsar. And it's a time when they're fighting the Swedes. Can you believe it? The Swedes actually were enemies and fighting vicious wars against the Russians and usually beating the Russians, which is rather fanciful if you think about the Sweden today. In any case, there is a very tangled love story involving a young woman named Maria who has a lover who is killed at the end. Well, before any of that happens, the orchestral prelude to the third act is, of course, Tchaikovsky pulling up all the stops. But it's interesting because it quotes two tunes you've probably heard before. One is from the coronation scene of Boris Godunov. Da di da da dum bum ba da 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 di di di. That theme, which, by the way, Beethoven used in Opus 59, number 2, string quartet in E minor, written for the Russian ambassador. So Beethoven used a Russian tune. That tune is used in the coronation scene. Now, some people point out that we might be startled to find this in an opera written about 10 years after Boris. This is the early 1880s. But in the early 1880s, I doubt if Tchaikovsky had heard the opera. No one regarded Boris as a great opera or a classic. It was a little-known opera that had a few performances. Its position was very, very uncertain. The other is a tune that you hear in the 1812 overture. It's the Russian national anthem, Long Live the Tsar. And here we have this prelude. Full roar.
Thank you.
around in the year 1680 or whenever this story is taking place. The Russian national anthem is, I think, written in the 19th century, but never mind the historical anachronisms on the part of Tchaikovsky. He knew what he was doing. This would appear to be the good old blood and thunder of Tchaikovsky Fourth Symphony, that kind of stuff. But the ending of this opera has to be one of the most original endings ever written by anybody in any opera, any place. And I'm going to play it for you. It's very short. You have the text there. This young woman, she's in fact pretty much lost her mind. She's wandering around. There's been terrible executions and brutalities. And she sees some corpses and she thinks it's her father. And she discovers it's her lover. She thinks he's dead, but he's actually alive. But in fact, he's dying. And he dies in her arms. And when he's dying, she sings a lullaby to him. In the last 3 minutes, the opera are the quietest music imaginable. I have to tell you, and forgive this little dig, this is a live performance from St. Petersburg. And all I can say is at the end of the performance, I would guess that there must be a large number of visiting New Yorkers because they interrupt the music with wild applause at the end. I thought that only happened in the Metropolitan Opera, where someday I'm going to be in the papers for strangling somebody that does this sort of thing. But never mind, it's still worth playing, and we'll pop over to that. I wanted to play the first 45 seconds of music. We'll have to go directly to the last bit. Thank you. There is a lot of blood and thunder in this opera, but there's also a great deal of subtlety. Imaginative choral scenes, wonderful arias, and the intervals of that performance, everybody was talking, why isn't this performed? It's absolutely a rich, wonderful opera, quite on the same level of the very finest of Tchaikovsky. And it's a very strange thing that it is almost never performed. I don't think it's ever staged in America. It might have been given a concert performance. Eve Quiller might have had a shot at it. But otherwise, it is a completely unknown work in this country. Funny enough, there is a historical opera that's based loosely on Schiller, which is the called The Gate of Orleans. That is a pretty blustery work on the whole, and I think probably the person might be a little disappointed when we hear that after the great subtlety and variety that one finds in operas such as Mazeppa, and certainly his very greatest operas, which of course are the two that are very directly based on Pushkin. This is loosely based on Pushkin as well. When Pushkin was in his early 20s, he began a novel in verse titled Yevgeny Onegin. The story is absurdly simple and banal. Two sisters live in the country. The younger sister is engaged to a rather silly young man who is a poet, who comes to visit with his best friend, who is kind of a bored, one of these kind of, oh my God, I'm bored, kind of Chekhovian characters that you see a lot in Russian theater pieces. Now these two men come to visit, and the friend, who's named Eugene Onegin, very much excites the older sister, who has no love interest in her life, Tatiana. She almost immediately is so shaken by meeting him that she sits down and writes a letter to him, pouring out her heart. The letter's delivered to him. He comes to her and slightly coldly, but at least politely says, I'm sorry, I'm not the marrying type. It would be terrible. The next day, it would be an icy, terrible relationship. And that's it. And the story goes on with a bizarre kind of disagreement between the two friends that leads to a duel. And Onegin fights his best friend and kills him. After the best friend sings the best tenor aria ever written by a Russian. The third act, 5 years ago, by Onegin has wandered around Europe. He comes back and goes to a party, and here is an elegantly dressed, beautiful woman and her sort of stuffed chair husband, and it's Tatiana. He takes one look at her and says, my God, she's beautiful. And he falls in love with her in sight. If the shoe is on the other foot, he has a few moments with her alone, and she says, I still love you. But I'm married to my husband, and I'm happy, and that's the way it is. And she leaves, and he's in despair. It's a very strange love story. There are no love duets in it. It's quite closely based upon the Pushkin. Pushkin is a novel in verse, 5,500 lines long. And it is said that almost every Russian who has any education at all can quote yards and yards and yards and yards, especially the letters seem, they all know it by heart. And that Tchaikovsky was very cautious about doing this, but he was persuaded to do it. He tried it out first in a student performance and wasn't sure it really would work anyway. And it didn't really succeed until about 20 years later when it was, 15 years later, when it was finally performed just before he died. It was a great success. And it shot to the top. It is, in fact, probably the single most loved Russian opera, apart from Boris Godunov, and one that has traveled a little more easily than Boris. It also is, it has a lot of this irony that's built into the poem itself, although Vladimir Nabokov, who has translated Yevgeny Onegin, and it's in 4 volumes. This is just the first volume here. Richard Zareskin knows more about Russian opera than anybody, says that Nabokov is a tone-deaf character. And in fact, he speaks of Tchaikovsky's slapdash version of the opera. There are a lot of other dissenting views about this. I want to go directly to that scene. It might appear to be a very predictable thing for me to play you, but I think it's a very subtle and a very extraordinary thing. I'm only playing part of it, and the clock may even encourage me to speed it up go. The entire aria is 13 minutes long. That is unbelievably long. It's interrupted with her sitting at the desk in the middle of the night and reflecting on what she's doing, of her thoughts, and pulling herself together. The poem in Nabokov's translation begins, "I write to you, what could one more? What else is there that I can say? 'Tis now I know within your will to punish me with scorn, but you preserving for my hapless lot at least one drop of pity, you'll not abandon me." The entire letter is there in this scene, written in the middle of the night. And the music is interesting because it moves from one key to another, and comes back to the first key. It's linked together, and when one studies it closely, in a way we can't in this situation, one finds it blows away this notion people have, which I cause to be one of these great emotional characters that identified with his characters and became swept away with emotion. Yes, he did identify with his characters, but he was a very professional composer, a very thoughtful composer, very professional. That's what Stravinsky said in 1940, the 100th anniversary of the birth of Tchaikovsky. And no one believed it, because everybody thought Mussorgsky was the great Russian composer, and Tchaikovsky was a second-rate sentimentalist. Stravinsky said, no, you have to pick one. Pick Tchaikovsky, he's the great one. And he's probably right. Here is Morella Freire as Tatiana. Wrong tape! I think, good God, she's aged. These things written part of it, rushes back to write more.
Thank you.
started with this key. 8 minutes before. That are at war within this woman in a very, very sensitive, very subtle way. And yes, there are a couple outbursts in the orchestra, and there's one great big gushy part from the voice, but it's surprisingly restrained. It also reveals perfectly the quality that Tchaikovsky has that is very rare among composers. And he is, in that sense, among the very finest. And that is an absolutely supreme melodic gift. In that respect, he's in there with Verdi and Mozart. I'm not sure who else. There are not very many really on that level. Supreme gift of melody. And when he focuses this in the manner that he does in this work, perfectly remarkable result. The other Pushkin work is based on a short story that is rather surrealistic, an amazing story, The Queen of Spades. I want to show you just one section of this, if you find it for me. At the very end, I'm going to give you about 3 minutes of research. The Queen of Spades is a thriller. In fact, it is the story that Dostoevsky was very struck by. And all you have to do is to think of the old woman in Crime and Punishment. It was an amazing link with the story of the old woman that you saw by accident. I put her on tape, the Countess in this story. The Countess is an old woman who in her youth had been the talk and the delight of society in Paris. And here again, it's that link with France that even shows up in this story. She's now a very old woman. She has a young niece that's living with her. The young niece catches the attention of the young man who's in the army named Clermont, who sort of falls in love with her, but he also has another motive, a deeper motive. He understands from the gossip that the old lady has a winning trick at cards, and we could just find out he would win his fortune. And he inveigles his way into the presence of this old woman by getting a key to the palace from the young girl. The girl thinks that he's going to come and spend the night and other things. And I'm sure he would enjoy that, but his real purpose is to come and see if he can confront this old woman and find out the secret to her cards. Now, this is a little too long, and I'll probably have to push through a little bit of it, but it's very interesting. She's sitting in a chair surrounded by her staff and her servants, and she's remembering her youth, and she even sings a song in French, and all these various French aristocrats were absolutely at her feet. She's remembering this with a smile. She's very, very elderly lady with her memories. Singing in French, little song. Shakes off her reverie. Hiding behind a pillar. Unfortunately, this singer looks like Jackie Gleason's nephew, but Ralph Cram. Thank you. music tells us that she senses somebody's there.
Thank you.
come to be with her. What's happened? And she immediately has a dawn on her. That he may have loved her, but it's not very clear. She certainly loved him, but this, the first thing out of his mouth was, she's dead, and the secret of the cards is gone with her. Incredibly, the Countess appears again. There is a scene, a little like the hallucination scene with the clock in Corsica, where he hallucinates and he has a vision of the old woman. Her ghost appears and she tells him the three cards, which lifts him out of his gloom. And the final act of the opera, he's at the gaming tables to use this formula. It's a 3, 7, and an ace. And I'm not quite sure how this works. I can hardly get through, you know, canasta or anything like that. But in drawing the cards, instead of an ace, it's the Queen of Spades. He loses everything. He stabs himself to death. She, the young girl, also comes to a terrible end. There is something very spooky, very much a mystery story about this opera in every way. And as I say, the situation with this elderly woman being confronted brutally by this young man can't help but make one think of Crime and Punishment. Dostoevsky, of course, was very, very struck by this. Dostoevsky gave a very famous lecture in honor of Pushkin in the 1880s. This was one of the later operas of Tchaikovsky, appeared in 1890. There was, in fact, only one or two after that. You may not know it, but the Nutcracker Ballet was a double bill with an opera called Iolanta, which is very little known because during the Soviet era it was never performed. It was extremely heavy in Christian symbolism. They just didn't touch it. Quite a beautiful, very, very lyrical opera. That was his very last one. This is the other great, very gripping, dark, probing, and very surrealistic opera that he based upon Pushkin. I promised you dessert. The man that wrote the most operas is the one who probably will have the least chance to see very often, and that is Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov. Mr. Gergiev came to Brooklyn a few years ago and brought one of the last operas, The Invisible City of Katesh. I didn't bother reading anything about it in advance, but I immediately was struck how much it was like Parsifal. I was very struck by it. Then I read that everybody said so. There was something very Wagnerian about this in a very almost a religious sense, a little bit akin to the Good Friday music and that sort of thing that you have in Parsifal. But on the whole, the operas that most strike us today are fairy tale operas based on legends and fairy tales and fantasy situations. And in 1899, which was the centenary of the birth of Pushkin, he wrote an opera called The Tale of Tsar Saltan. Now, there's a problem here. I do have a recording of it. Done by the Dresden Opera auf Deutsch. But never mind. There's about 3 minutes of music that I think very much confirms what some people have said, that this is an opera that occasionally makes you think of Petrushka, which was only about 10 years later. And of course, was written by a pupil of Rimsky-Korsakov, Igor Stravinsky. Now that's often said. I also have to say that I hear it in a very interesting way, a little bit of Meistersinger, a kind of Russian Meistersinger. Maybe it's because they're singing in German, and they say Preisen and Loben and all these wonderful German words. I'm going to play you 3 minutes of it. It's very colorful. It's a fantasy where the young hero shows up on an island and instantly there's a magic city and they're greeting you with great festivities. And 2 minutes later comes something that you have always heard and never knew where it came from. First, these 3 minutes. Prince Gidon and his Mutter.
Mutter! Mutter! Mutter ist das eine Stadt, so hast du es auch beschrieben. Dort, wo gestern Wüsten Neid war, blitzen goldene Türmchen auf. Leuchtet hell, strahlt dieses Ding.
Oh!
mir zur Seite, will als Zar ich gern euch stützen.
Well, you get the general idea. It's a very colorful, tuneful, brilliantly orchestrated piece. It's a lot of fun because the sheer color. This man was a great orchestrator, and of course that's where Stravinsky learned his tricks of his trade. Well, you may have wondered where this came from. Striking thing, the pupil of Nikolai Rimsky-Korsakov, Igor Stravinsky, when after the First World War, he was clear he wasn't going home for a while because the communists had taken over. He went back at the age of 80 and was received like a long-lost son. But he'd just made up by then. He knew he wasn't going back, and culturally he was less and less in touch with Russia and cut off. His last composition with Russian words is a little half-hour opera called Mavra, based on a text by, guess who, Alexander Pushkin, which is a wonderful way to kind of round up this direct connection between this tradition that goes back more than a century over to a young Russian composer living in Paris, cut off from his homeland, and having to do the opposite from what the Russians did. The Russians had to fight to get back their own language, and he had to say goodbye to his language. He had to begin to write in French. There's an interesting and slightly bittersweet symmetry in this story. Russian opera is wonderful, and thankfully we're getting videotapes of it because we can't often see it in the opera house. Although whenever Mr. Gergiev shows up, we should go and see him. They've just done an opera by Prokofiev based on Dostoevsky called The Gambler, and that orchestra turned into the Kirov Orchestra. It was glorious. Mr. Gergiev is marvelous. Pay close attention to him. Very good guide to this wonderful, rich heritage of Russian opera. Thank you very much. If you have any questions, come and bombard me. Thank you.
Thank you.
been in Russia, right? I meet people that go there and they're glad to went to one of the places. Most people I know say, I was there for a month, I can't get it out of my mind. When something goes wrong in Russia, I agonize over it. It's as if it's my country. I love the Russian. It's a sad country. Are you thinking of a video or a CD? Get this box right here. This is again from Larry Gergiev and the reason the booklet is so fat is they have both versions. They have two CDs for the first version, and then they have three CDs for the 1872 version. They have both of them. They even have different casts for them. And lots of notes in various languages and all the text. That's wonderful because you can decide which one you mix and match.
That's right. Get the best of all of them.
But this, if you can, Boris, yes, this is wonderful.
That's on three CDs.
Five, because they give you everything. But if you want to have a really superlative visual record, it would be this. Again, Mr. Gregory, I'm not related to you. I'm getting a rake off of you, but he's wonderful. And this wonderful cast and Tarkovsky stage, which I think is very wonderful.
Okay.
Janet,
okay.
Oh, yes, yes.
You used to work for one of the singers, Jerome Hines.
Oh, you did?
Yes.
Oh, my goodness, yes. He's still alive, isn't he?
His wife.
He must be in his 80s.
Yes.
He was singing very recently, I know.
Yes.
Oh, yeah, he was a marvelous. Can
you say, though, if
you want to I didn't get to mention that. It's often sung by elderly singers. Leonie Riesenick sang it at the very end of her career, which was wonderful. No, this is all Russian cast. The name may not ring a bell. It's Ludmila Filatova. It has Maria Guladina and Olga Borodina. They're very well-known singers. Sergei Leverkus is a well-known singer. But of course, these are singers we're just hearing about for the first time. She might have, but I completely forgot to tell this group that there is a short opera by Rimsky-Korsakov called Mozart and Salieri. It's the Amadeus story. It's exactly the same as Amadeus and a short opera text by Pushkin. He didn't miss a thing. I wish I'd mentioned that. It's on the list of operas. Yeah, I don't know. Ian Kreller is the kind of person who would do that kind of an opera. But I don't believe it's ever been staged in this kind of much. I don't know. Except for the care of God, it cries out to be performed on stage. It's a brilliant spectacle.
Well, it was in the Richardson Auditorium. Yeah. It's a spectacle.
Here for us.
Yeah.
Sure.
Thank you very much.
It's a pleasure.
How are you very possible?
I didn't get to go yet. I heard on the radio I'm going Friday.
Oh,
I'm going to hear the Good Friday music on Good Friday.
Oh, okay.
Did you go?
No, well, yes, I've been the night before the last. But have you heard about the White Knights Festival in Russia?
Oh, yeah. I'd love to go sometime.
Yeah.
I'm very homesick for St. Petersburg. It's 39 years ago that I was there. Long time.
Well, I wanted to thank you very much. I enjoyed it. And I'm sorry to say that I have commitments for the rest of your lecture series.
Oh, dear.
And I didn't want you to think I didn't like it.
No, I
really loved it.
That's very kind of you. Thank you so much.
But thank you so much.